City of a Thousand Spies. Written by Kathryn Guare and read for you by Wayne Farrell. Chapter 1. When people say that they do not remember what they do in a fit of fury, they talk nonsense. It is false. I remember everything. From Leo Tolstoy's novella, The Kreutzer Sonata. As soon as night falls, darkness becomes your weapon. Use it or you'll find it used against you. She scrambled up the steep incline, repeating the words to herself like a mantra, like a prayer she was trying to believe in, willing them to produce the effect she needed. Invisibility, concealment. When Conor had offered this advice, his face solemn as if reciting a piece of ancient wisdom, she tried to match his mood, but ended up annoying him with an ill-timed giggle. Kate wasn't laughing now. The situation was more frightening than anything she'd prepared for, and her strategy was unraveling. Instead of heading for the summit, she should have taken the last side trail to slip back along a different route. She'd realized her mistake a few minutes earlier, when the forested mountainside began dropping away. It seemed as though the unseen hand of an artist was rubbing at the scenery, thinning the composition. The higher she climbed, the fewer the trees. Eventually, there would be none. She would emerge like wild game flushed from its cover, a solid, unobstructed target. It was too late to double back now, but with the cloud cover of a March evening speeding its arrival, the weapon she'd been waiting for finally appeared. Darkness. It poured over the mountain, an inky tide arriving exactly on time. Within a shrinking sphere of visibility, Kate paused to listen for a sign of pursuit. Earlier, she'd been able to detect it, a distant thump of booted feet on the trail, more vibration than sound, methodical, relentless. The beat of it in the ground under her feet had unnerved her, but its absence was worse. Pebbles from eroding stone shifted beneath her feet. She cringed at the rattle echoing through the otherwise silent forest. Scrambling up the final steep section of rock, she pulled herself onto an outcrop of ledge and stood motionless on the summit. At the corner of her eye, something shivered in a thicket of evergreens, and she spun to face it. A bird, a rustle of wind, something else. Kate focused on the indistinct shape of the trees, but the movement had subsided. She relaxed and took a long breath, wiping the sweat from her forehead. But when she turned, he was right there, his dark figure filling the space in front of her, extinguishing what light remained. She screamed and reflexively took a step away, then felt herself toppling back over the edge. A hand shot out and yanked her forward. She heard him grunt as one of her windmilling arms connected with his chin. Off balance himself, he slammed her onto the ground and fell on top of her. Kate landed hard, flat on her back, and felt the air explode from her lungs like a shot being fired. In one fluid movement, the figure rolled away and up onto his knees, then loomed so close she could feel his breath on her face. "Kate, you all right? Did I hurt you?" Trying to speak, she managed only an urgent hiccup and lay still, struggling not to panic at the clenched paralysis of her lungs. "Damn, sorry, love." Connor's dark eyes flashed, wide and startled. "The wind's knocked out of you. Try to relax. It won't last long." It felt like hours, though it was probably no more than a few seconds before her diaphragm relaxed and Kate sucked a gulp of air past the pain in her chest. He waited until her breathing grew less desperate, and then in a manner more clinical than either one of them was used to, he slipped his hands beneath her fleece jacket, watching her face while he probed her ribs. Once satisfied she wasn't seriously injured, Connor gave her a cheerful smile. "No bones broken?" Kate pushed his hands away and sat up. "No thanks to you. What the hell was that anyway? You told me this was a chase exercise. You were supposed to be behind me, chasing. You told me to evade and listen for signs of pursuit." I also told you to stay alert, and I did chase you. But then I peeled away to the right and got ahead of you. Connor smiled. I didn't think it was going to work so well. You're proud of yourself for knocking me senseless? Ah, go on, you know that's not true. His face sobered. Listen, I'm sorry, but this is what it's like, and anyway, can I remind you that all this getting a jump start business was your idea? I know, Kate scowled. I should have seen you. I was just distracted by something in that tree over there. So that was me as well. I threw a stone into it, and you stood staring like you thought it would get up and walk away. That's something to remember. You need to be able to look at more than one thing at a time. Okay, I want this lesson to be over now. But you were the one who... Over! Right so. He ducked his head, hiding a grin as he shrugged a backpack from his shoulders. After pulling out a thermos and several plastic containers, he removed a small lantern clipped to the side of the pack. Turning it on, he placed it on the rock between them. What's all this? Kate peered down at the display. Candlelight supper, courtesy of Chef Abigail. It's a long walk down and it's already dark, so we might as well eat first. My God, you're a genius. She leaned over to reward him with a kiss, running her fingers through his tousled black hair. It was worth it, just for this. Well, let's see if you still think so by the time we get home. He had a point. Table Rock, far from the highest mountain peak in Vermont, was not a difficult hike in daylight, but it was a precarious descent in the dark, even when wearing headlamps. And after reaching the parking lot, they still had an hour's drive ahead of them. It was after 9 o'clock when Connor turned the truck onto the driveway of the Rembrandt Inn. Since purchasing the property 6 years earlier, Kate had continued the tradition of closing the hotel for the months of March and April, the state's least photogenic period in the calendar year and a dormant time for tourism. Famous for playing cruel tricks with its weather patterns, Vermont served as a sort of proving ground in early spring, in a way that even the heartiest natives found challenging. As a transplant from New York, Kate had experienced her share of soul-testing moments, but she'd learned to cope and to appreciate anything that helped remind her why she'd fallen in love with the place. Like right now, for example. With a pale moon hanging in the sky over its roof and the porch light shining, the inn looked particularly charming as they pulled up in front of it. Her legs sore and her back stiffening, Kate gathered her strength before sliding from the passenger seat, while Connor stood holding the door for her, his face unreadable. He could be good at that trick, projecting a blank slate without visible effort. She'd first seen that polite, impenetrable mask when he showed up on an April evening almost a year ago, an emigrant Irishman burdened with a stash of secrets he was determined to keep hidden. He'd arrived with an unconventional resume, a farmer who'd stopped farming, a professional violinist who'd stopped playing. Once settled under her roof, he'd begun applying himself to both again, and before the end of that year, Kate had poked her way through all his cautious evasions and given up secrets of her own, and they'd discovered others together that neither could have imagined. They'd suffered and healed together during that time as well, and now Connor's opaque facades were less effective with her. He couldn't often fool her. He didn't often try. But tonight Kate knew he was trying to hide his distress. His mission for the evening had been to stalk and terrify her. He'd done it well and had banged her up in the process. But any heartfelt apologies would defeat the ostensible purpose of the exercise, to prepare her for more of the same, as well as his unacknowledged objective, which was to put her off the project altogether. Prodded by rebellious instinct, Kate shook off her weariness. She reached into the bed of the truck to lift the heavy backpack, but this effort to prove her resilience was too much for Connor. She wasn't surprised when he stepped forward to take it from her. Hot shower, he said, casually throwing the pack over his shoulder. She gave his hand a squeeze. I like the way you think. Connor knew it was coming. He could see it in the set of her chin. An argument was on the way, and 20 minutes together in her spacious walk-in shower had postponed, but not preempted it. While toweling off, he watched Kate with guarded suspicion. Wrapped in a blue silk robe, She stood at the bathroom sink, staring at her reflection, and shedding water from her toothbrush with rhythmic taps against the porcelain. A fate motif worthy of Beethoven. It sent him scuttering into the adjoining bedroom in search of escape, but he'd mistimed the strike. She waited until they were lying in bed together, her head on his shoulder, one hand trailing over his chest. Very clever, he thought. Attack when I'm most vulnerable. It wasn't hard to put him off balance in this room anyway. He'd been occupying the master suite for a while now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.